This is the 20th day of October, 2022. Can we begin with a roll call?
Roger Daniel.
Here.
Jeremy Lukinas.
Here.
Matt Dixon.
Here.
Jim Stabler.
Here.
Andy Brickler. Sam Cornwell.
Here.
You have quorum.
Let's see. Are we at six members there?
We have six members now.
Okay. Now, were there any applications before the council? Or?
Yes. So, are you asking for the staff report for 26, the first one? Or? He just submitted his resignation, probably. Levi Kramer submitted his resignation about 3 days ago.
Okay.
So I passed it to the clerk of council. The requirements for what historic commission needs, what we have already fulfilled, and then a short grade resume from that.
Okay.
Or request.
So we'll have a swearing in of witnesses. Do you solemnly swear that any testimony you give today will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
All right, has everybody received the minutes of August 18th, 2022?
Yes.
Everybody had an opportunity to review them?
Yes.
Did anybody note any corrections or omissions?
No, I did not.
Okay.
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes as submitted.
Do we have a second?
I'll second.
All right. All in favor, say aye.
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 Any opposed, same sign. The minutes of August 18th, 2022 meeting of the Historic Commission are approved. Okay, the first item on the agenda is a certificate of appropriateness for the Highlands Historic District for 2607 Sherman Avenue. Do we have a staff report?
We do. So the 2607 Sherman Avenue was a held-over application from, I believe, August. Issuance of a certificate of appropriateness for the installation of the new fence and roof-mounted solar panels. The roof-mounted solar panels was added, I believe, about a week and a half, 2 weeks ago, for added to the COA, added to the application. This property was built in 1977. This two-story Tudor in Brook home was a single-family, six bedrooms, four and a half baths. 0.3 acres. Next slide. The applicant is proposing installation of a new 4 foot tall chain link fence. This will go in the back portion of their property, only on the back portion of their property, and they intend to plant ivy along the fence once it's installed. So it'll appear to look like the image that the applicant supplied. Additionally, they would like to install roof mounted solar panels. I asked the applicant to provide some type of visual effect where they will be located on the property, where we'll be located on the house, which is on the back portion of the house, but did not provide any additional details or illustrations, graphics, etc.
Okay.
On the next slide, you'll see the zoning district is zoned R2, back portion of the property, basically right along the R2 is the only location where the fence will be, and as previously mentioned, the applicant stated the solar panels would be on the rear portion of the house, rear portion of the roof. Next slide. Other approvals and permits required. One would be a certificate of zoning compliance for the fence. Roof mounted solar panels only require an electric permit that I am aware of. Then any person directly affected by the decision of the zoning code administrator or the historic commission shall have the right to appeal to the planning commission, provided that a written application for appeal is filed within 20 calendar days after the decision, notice, or order was received.
Okay.
That is my staff report.
All right. Would someone like to make a motion to waive the reading of the ordinances? Those for me.
I'll make that motion.
All right. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right. Is the applicant present?
The applicant is not present.
All right. Is there any member of the public that wish to speak in favor of the application? There being no response, is there any member of the public that would wish to speak against the application? There being no response, is there anyone that would wish to make a motion to end the public forum?
Make a motion to close the public forum.
One second.
One second.
Okay.
Or you can say it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, is there any discussion amongst the commission?
Have we historically been approving chain link fences?
Yeah.
Is there any code in our book that says anything about fencing material?
There is. Chain link fence cannot be surrounding the entire perimeter of a residentially zoned parcel. So just on a portion of it, just like how she has, would be permitted in any other zoning district. The reason why a fence is brought forth to you is because it's in a historic district, not a conservancy district, and additionally, that a fence can alter the appearance or the aesthetic of a historic property.
Well, I'm not sure with 1977 that this is quite falling into the
might be
historic
exactly,
period.
But
However,
it's in the district.
Yeah, it is in the district. Honestly, this image that they provided looks more like a wood lattice.
It is.
They're attaching wood lattice to it, the way it looks. And then they're putting plastic vines on there until they're real vines. Take root.
Yeah, I'm okay with the solar panels, not so much.
What is it, replacing an existing chain link fence, or is it a completely new fence?
So the property is fenced, I believe, on all sections except that rear portion, which she's just adding a small portion of her fence to enclose the property.
Okay.
So there's already a chain link fence there?
It's her neighbor's fences that wrap around her property. On the back portion, I'm not exactly sure.
Do you know what they're made of?
I don't. There's a significant amount of trees and bushes and stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is basically just the back of the property, though.
Right. Probably not visible from the road.
And probably be more comfortable with it if we knew what the other fencing material that existed already was.
I don't see that the neighbors have any fences, at least on the south side.
Does Google say when that street view is?
Yeah, 2013.
2013?
Yeah, unfortunately. Yeah, that's the newest that they've got right there.
Additionally, this house does want to paint the garage in that portion. That's the lime green.
Mm-hmm.
It's not something that you guys need to approve.
Mm-hmm.
Just making you aware of the situation in case you drive by and you want to give me a phone call.
Yeah.
Are we not approving it because it's considered a non-contributing structure?
The paint?
No, I meant the garage.
Oh. No, they're just painting the garage door and then the lime green portion that's kind of the front facade of their house. Painting a home is generally not something that you would have to review unless it drastically alters.
No, we decided we did review colors.
So Austin
Muser
pushed us. Historically, we had not approved colors. And he said it would be better for the Historic Commission to approve, to take that on, because it would strengthen other things that we do, that if we were picking and choosing what we were and were not.
We're reviewing different historic palettes from different providers and all sorts of things.
Yeah, so we kind of had some idea of what we were doing. We never set it in stone, but we were approving colors in the historic districts.
Okay.
We turned a couple down.
Unfortunately, it's not in the development code. It still states previously that basic maintenance.
I think it does say color.
I feel like
I think it always did. I think it had historically said color, and we ignored it.
Right, because we didn't want to get in the.
Right.
We didn't have any standards to apply. So people would basically be just saying we were arbitrarily imposing our
rules. Yeah,
says color,
yeah.
I will double check on that.
I can't see.
Well, regardless, I think it is a non-contributing structure.
So the whole house is a non-contributing.
Yeah, so I'm not sure if we have any.
But it's still.
Yeah, it can detract from the neighborhood.
Well, we're going from lime green.
These houses.
To white.
Yeah.
Sure can see it.
I said brown when I saw the application.
Might have been brown on the application, she told me white over the phone, but regardless, I think it'll be better than lime green.
Yeah, if you already told them to paint it, by all means.
I didn't tell them to paint it,
yeah.
But.
But if
you
we.
Told them not to add it to the application.
I told her it was not needed to the application.
Yeah. In the future, this one, we do, because we have had some incidents of people just slamming color on their house. We have one on South Main right now that's just painting gray on white metal siding. And that is something we should have brought through and approved. We've got a house that has like Ronald McDonald colors.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's kind of what we decided on. I don't see any other fences, but this is an old street view. Again, those are such nice houses. I don't think a chain link fence is appropriate there, personally.
Yeah. Well, if we knew that there was already chain link fence enclosing the property, given that it's in the back and it's going to be screened by vegetation, I'm not sure that I would have a problem with it.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I was going to say, typically it's from the street, and it doesn't look like you can see that from the street. There's fences on the side. Let's say
yeah.
It's wood fence, you would never even see the fence.
Yeah.
So.
It's on the rear of the property, which is actually going to back up against someone else's yard.
Yeah,
right. Yeah.
It's kind of, it's in a cul-de-sac, or not a cul-de-sac, but it's on a corner. So all these nice houses right here are going to have chain link fence in their backyard if they don't already. Those are awfully nice houses. I can see a split rail back here. I just don't think that chain link belongs there. But if everybody else had it, then
mm-hmm.
it'd be different.
They are going to cover up the vegetation, so you're not even going to see the fence anyways.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Can you actually see the backyard?
Yeah, you can zoom
yeah.
in a little bit.
That's that? Okay.
And you can see, but the house that we're talking about is over here. I'm just being considerate of the people that live around it. I mean, it's all kind of overgrown with brush, so it's hard to tell about the property.
Yeah, you can see the house.
Yeah. And this house here on the other corner is really well landscaped, really nice. They for sure do not have a chain link fence in their backyard. I would feel guilty putting a chain link fence in behind them people.
All right. If there's no further discussion, is there a motion?
I would make a motion to approve the solar panels and deny the chain link fence.
Do we have a second for that motion? All right, if you can call the vote.
Roger Daniel?
Yes and no, I guess. Well, basically, I approve the
motion.
The motion, yes.
Okay. Jeremy Lekinas?
Yes.
Matt Dixon?
Yes.
Jim Stabler?
Yes.
Sam Cornwell?
Yes. You're the only one to say no.
That's okay.
That's fine. We don't have to have unanimous consent. It's better
yes
if we
yes for the solar panels and yes for the.
So
perfectly
no on the
okay.
motion.
That's
yeah.
perfect. That is absolutely perfectly okay.
I think that if the shy of you will get out of
yeah, and here's the thing, you might not be able to see it from this way, but it's like a football field down the Alameda. Like you can see
I don't remember, because I lived in that area.
Yeah.
I don't remember if it's
and
there.
That's what I was wanting to see, because there are no obstructions on this side.
I don't remember anybody having to
right.
Yeah,
okay, you're looking right at it, so you would see it over there.
Yeah, and that's my only concern is seeing it from other angles. If everyone else had a chain link fence, I'd be all for it, whatever. Just blending it, but if it's just some.
But they're only putting the fence on the back side.
Right.
As far as I'm aware.
So how does that work? Let's say they end up putting a fence on the side. How do we?
Somebody has to catch them first.
Oh, if they like, if they put a fence without our knowledge, generally code enforcement would go out there and begin the process of citing them. They'd let me, they'd make me aware. I would then have to write them a letter asking them to please apply for a COA.
Okay.
And then we'd start that process.
Gotcha.
Then we deny it, we leave it in place. We'd ask for criminal charges to be brought, they'd be dropped. But then they sell the property to someone else with the fence already in place, and there would be absolutely nothing to do about it.
Limited.
So that's what I'm looking
for. Yeah, limited power. We've had limited. We hope that when we show up and James shows up with code enforcement that people go, oh, we're sorry, we'll stop right now and fix it. But if they don't, we really don't have a lot we can do. The law department has not taken an aggressive stance in the like 7 years I've been here on to pull that out.
So particularly why I'm asking that is because I just don't recall any fences being in those yards. The fences that I do recall were more of like a wrought iron aluminum style fence in that area. At my house, I had to do the same thing.
Yeah.
And so I can understand where you guys are coming from, but as I'm thinking, like, okay, it's on the back side of the property. We might not be able to see it, but from the side view, you can see it.
Yeah.
I guess I would feel more comfortable knowing what was on the side. I just don't know what's on the side.
I mean, and that's part of it. It's like we can, if we're making deviations, if people come in with that information and persuade us or not. But when we're, I mean, I guess the default is that if we don't have all the information, we need to decide to not approve.
So what's your point?
Yeah, they should have come in.
Okay.
I'm gonna stick with it.
They should have come in.
Yeah, I mean, it's always helpful when we have questions.
All right. Next item on the agenda, certificate of appropriateness, South Main Historic District, 50 South Main Street. Do we have a report from the staff?
We do. This is for an issuance of certificate of appropriateness for the replacement of a roof. 50 South Main Street is a three-story brick building in the South Main Historic District. The proposal of work, the applicant is proposing replacement of the roof. All images are provided by the applicant. Bottom left-hand corner are the black asphalt shingles that the applicant intends to install on the roof. And the pictures to the right-hand side, both the top and bottom, show that the roof currently is silver metal material. Next slide shows that 50 South Main Street is on the intersection of Central and South Main. It's right across from the Sorg Opera House. Additionally, this would not require a certificate of zoning compliance. This would only require a building permit. That is my staff report. The applicant is not here.
And this is the point where I wish that we had an engineer. All right.
Well, I thought that was basically a flat roof.
Yes, that's what I was thinking, but I don't have that expertise.
Slightly pitched from what I've seen from when I've been out there. It's a three-story roof that is kind of coming down at an angle. I couldn't tell you the slope, but I could tell you that it is pitched.
All right, let's go through the formality at least of opening and closing the public forum, even though we did have nobody here, just so it's on the record. All right, is there any member of the public that wishes to speak in favor of the application? There being no response, is there any member of the public that wishes to speak against the application? There being no response, do we have a motion? Do we have a second?
Oh, I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right, the public forum is closed. Now we'll have board discussion.
One additional thing that I do want to mention, the applicant did say the roof is leaking.
Mm-hmm.
So they were pressed to get this complete.
I don't know if you put a shingle roof on a roof that doesn't have a sufficient slope if it actually.
It's pretty
works
steep.
Well.
It's if you look at it, and I just saw this the other day when we were at the wire end back. I actually watched them.
You're
on
right,
that
it
roof.
Is pretty steep.
That's the building right next door to the Pickwick building.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So this is the back of the front of the building in this
mm-hmm.
picture, and you can see the slope coming off the front part. This whole side over here is sloped at an angle to the south,
okay.
and it's the same pitch.
Do they have to get a permit for a roof?
Yeah.
They would have to go through the building department. The building department would have to go out there and review them, and they would have to have a, I believe they'd have to have a licensed general contractor. But
so we could approve it barring the building inspection department says it's okay to use that material.
Well, yeah, I think everything we do is basically that.
Yeah.
I mean, we can't give them permission to use something that the building inspector doesn't. Well, if we are looking for a new person, maybe we should prioritize reaching out to engineers too.
It was nice having Joanne.
Mm.
I do miss having an architect sitting here.
I mean, I don't think that it is. I guess the next question is it the sort of roof that this sort of building would have historically had? And if it isn't, is it visible enough for that to be an issue?
I had a cedar shake roof.
It can't be seen from the street at all, and the picnic building's got those same shingles on it.
Okay.
Can it be seen from the rear? But the alley back?
The only place it can be seen from it, if you're in the patio back at the Schweyer Inn, because that's where I was watching them run around on the roof. So you can see it there. But then again, the building right next to it, the Pickwick building, virtually has the same shingles. They're almost identical.
The same being like this, you mean?
The same
yeah.
as the new style that they're wanting to go to?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm pretty sure they're almost identical.
Pickwick, to me, didn't seem as flat as I thought this was. I see the Pickwick as being a
well, this
of
has got a pretty, if you look at this, it's kind of hard, but it's got an angle. This, it's angled, it doesn't have a hip roof, it's angled from the north side down to the south side like this, like a wedge. You don't see it from the front because of the facade.
Mm-hmm.
See, that angles down, see this right here?
Right.
That's where the two meet. So that's a pretty good, I was watching this guy run around on that, and I thought, man, why is he doing that?
I would think shingle to shingle that roof would be way more expensive than to replace it with what's on there.
Well, I think what's on there is steel. I think it's the old standing rib.
So they could put down like that rubber sheet and stuff.
Yeah, probably underneath it and everything. That's the original product of Armco. They're probably going to rip all that off and put plywood and then put shingles on it.
What are all the other, has anyone else replaced their roof in the last 5 to 10 years?
The Swire did, but they tore a slate roof off and put a shingle roof on and didn't get a COA. That's been the only one. It was gone from one material to another. The one next to it, when you say Pickwick,
that's the old
historic commission.
Is that the building that's to the left here?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's the red brick building.
Okay. Because I thought she had standing seam, metal seam as well.
It may be on that part, but the other part we replaced is a flat roof, and then on the back coming out, that's got regular shingles on it, I'm pretty sure.
I'm okay with whatever the group thinks.
Well, I don't think any of us really have the credentials to really say a whole lot about what we're discussing
it,
here.
Just if can you see it from the street? That's the only thing you
I don't
really
think
can.
I don't think you can.
No,
like I said, the only thing you can see is from the back of the building if you're going down the alley back there.
And if that gets a roof on one of our old buildings. So it's probably more than that, honestly.
Yeah, because this is the Pickwick building right here. I really can't tell, but that's pretty sure that's all shingles.
My parents just did a rubber roof replacement on a building half that that size, and it was $65,000.
Oh yeah.
So I mean, it's not cheap.
Anyone that want to tell them to go out and get quotes for slate? No. Okay. All right, do we have a second?
I'll second.
All right, roll call.
Sam Cornwell?
Yes.
Jim Stabler?
Yes.
Matt Dixon?
Yes.
Jamie Lukianis?
Yes.
Roger Daniel?
Yes.
All right, the next item on the agenda is certificate of appropriateness for the Highlands Historic District, 613 Baltimore Street. Do we have a staff report?
We do. So this is for issuance of a certificate of appropriateness for the remodel of the exterior of the home, a new garage, and a new fence. Property history is 2700, oh, it's wrong property history, but it's a single family, two-story home. It was on the demolition list. I'm not sure if you've seen it lately. Last time I went out there was a few weeks ago. There's a car-sized hole in the wall. If you're looking at the house, it's to the left. So this is home that was taken off the demolition list per the applicant, and they would like to repair the home, hopefully to its primer glory. The next two slides indicate what the home, what they would like it to look like. So it looks like they're primarily keeping the wood siding, just repainting it, new windows, new roof, new porch, new door. I mean, basically redoing everything, adding a white picket fence. And as you can see in the back would be a two-story garage. If you have any questions about regulations on the garage, I could go through that real quick.
I do.
Okay. So accessory structures such as this garage would be permitted. They can be as tall. They cannot be as tall or taller than the house, but they can be like a two-story building. This cannot be an accessory dwelling unit. So nobody can live in this garage. This could be it could be like a playroom, it could be a playhouse, it cannot be another living unit. The backyard cannot extend more than 25%, of the backyard, which this possibly would be. I don't know if this is to scale, but when approving this, you could approve it as it would still have to be approved with a certificate of zoning compliance. So if you approve it, as it's illustrated, when it comes time for the certificate of zoning compliance, the garage might not be approved as it cannot be larger than 25% of their backyard. She could go to the Board of Zoning Appeals for an area and dimensional variance, but that's going off on a tangent.
Where's the driveway?
I believe it would have to be on the back side. All garages do have to have a paved driveway going from the street into the garage. They do have an alley. There is an alley with a rear access that could potentially enter into the garage. Not sure if that's something that they're going to have or not. That would be another limiting factor for the garage. If they don't have something, ultimately they could say it's a shed. Or they could say it's another unit. Doesn't necessarily have to be a garage, but that's what they labeled it as. So,
is there a garage there now?
There was a garage, but I believe as of 2007, it was demolished. Second last slide, you'll see that here's the zoning map. Zoning map still shows that there is a garage on site. There is not a garage on site currently. The house is still there, still standing. Other permits that would need to be approved would be a certificate of zoning compliance for basically everything they would like to do to the house, the fence, and whatever accessory structure that may be, whether it's a shed, a garage, whatever whatever it may be, if that gets approved. And additionally, they would need quite a slew of different permits from the building department, including electric, the building department, building permit, and possibly HVAC and plumbing if they need to redo that as well. I don't know if they need to do that, so that's why I didn't put it on. Don't know if they need to do electric, that's why I didn't put it on, but minimum, they'll need a building permit.
Do you know anything about the composition of the windows, the siding?
I do not. This is in the Oakland Conservancy District, so the reason it's before you is because it's considered a major alteration. I was not provided any more details than what I provided to you in your staff packet, which was essentially the filled out application and the various illustrations.
Honestly, I don't think that we got enough information to approve it or deny it.
You go along with that?
A motion to continue is always possible, and you can have me reach back out to the applicant to detail all the different changes that she would like to do, materials that she would like, et cetera.
Because I think we'd have trouble if it was vinyl siding.
Do we know when this
application? Maybe vinyl windows.
Yeah. Do we know when this application was submitted?
It could still be pushed back to the next meeting. The only one that would be automatically approved would have been 2607.
Mm-hmm.
So this could still be reviewed by the next meeting and still meet within the 60-day window. But you've already reviewed it today, so.
Now, we have to vote and have a final disposition of it within that time.
Within 60 days, I believe so. So that ends my staff report, and the applicant is not here.
I mean, replacing an old, previously existing garage with a new garage, an old fence with a new fence, redoing the exterior of the home, given the condition that the exterior of the home is in. We don't have a problem in principle with any of that, but we don't know what materials they're going to use. We don't know what's going to happen with the windows. We don't know what's going to happen with the doors. We don't know what sort of fence this is going to be. It's like we might be able to speculate given of these drawings, as we don't have, we have very little information about how the garage is going to be built, if they're going to be putting down a new slab, if they're going to be adding a drive, if what materials it's going to be made of, whether it's going to match the house.
This garage looks like an additional residence.
Right. Yeah, I mean, it's one thing to say that you're going to have a second story on your garage, which is not going to be used as a residence, but 3 years from now, if someone is basically living in it, exactly what are we
doing? Because there's no account for a garage door in the alley.
Mm-hmm.
So it's clearly not a garage.
Mm-hmm. Size limitations on sheds, though, if they're over 200 square feet, they just have to match the exterior of the front of the primary dwelling, if visible from the public right away. So as long as it's made of the same material, same aesthetic, it can be permitted. Ultimately, though, accessory units or accessory building structures,
mm-hmm.
just like this, still has to be 25% of the backyard. They cannot exceed 25% of the backyard.
I mean, it's a really nice looking plan. I mean, I would buy this house if it was done like this plan. But it doesn't look like they're turning.
Given some of the infill things that they were proposing for Oakland, were going to essentially have houses that were filling almost the entire lot, having an accessory dwelling that more or less does the same, I wouldn't expect they might liberally grant a zoning variance on it. But
so let me ask it. House next door has vinyl siding. It's less than a couple feet away from the house. How do we tell a resident that's right next door, sorry, you can't have the same material?
Because it was grandfathered in. That vinyl siding existed before it was a historic district. If they're grandfathered in, if they ever take that siding off, they're not going to be able to put vinyl back on. But as long
extension to that statement is when we did the National Register application, the consultants went and pulled back siding, the vinyl siding on all those houses that have vinyl, to see that the wood is still there. And they had to actually check box, yes, there is still hard boards underneath there, in order to demonstrate to the government that we have sufficient architectural elements left in that neighborhood for it to be a district. So we kind of have to put the kibosh on vinyl, and if anybody takes it off, they can't put it back on. Are they proposing, are they even, have they said what they wanted to do with
this? They probably don't know what the bill of material required is.
They would like to live there? Sorry, Sam, what was your question?
So you probably don't know what the bill of materials are, right?
When I asked her questions to provide all building materials, all that information, she stated that I believe it was her significant other, who is the builder contractor, and she's just chopping off the application, the illustrations.
Okay. We have lots of questions.
Yeah. Unfortunately, we might have to motion to deny until we know what some of those things are.
Well, if we can get it, if the next meeting, and if we have a quorum for the next meeting, mm-hmm. is within 60 days. I think you may be right, though, given the proximity of the meeting to Thanksgiving, and it's like assuming that we're going to have a quorum in November may be unwarranted.
That would be, I'm not supposed to persuade you guys by any means. I'm not doing this right now. I'm just saying if you do a motion to continue, you don't have a meeting next month that would be automatically approved.
Right.
I'll make a motion to deny.
Okay. With... I know I'm the chair, but I want to make change the motion so that basically deny with a request that they resubmit with more information.
Okay. So you're
what Matt said.
Okay.
I will second that.
All right. We have a motion and a second. We're gonna do a roll call.
Roger Daniel?
Yes.
Jimmy Lakinas?
Yes.
Matt Dixon?
Yes.
Jim Stabler?
Yes.
Sam Cromwell?
Yes.
So we need to encourage these people to show up.
Yeah.
I have two things real quick for new and old business. First one was back in August, Jeremy, you asked me about 125 South Main Street. Why have we not been able to nail down code enforcement and to continue? Spoke to the code enforcement. I'm not sure if she's an officer or what, but code enforcement about it. And she stated that this building changes hands. So as Matt, as you mentioned, there's several different stickers or tickets they have to give a particular property before they can bring them into the court. And it changed hands, I guess, twice since then. So it's kind of the sticky situation of trying to nail down the property. Currently, the property is abandoned, and I believe that we're getting ready to board it up. So that is for 125 South Main. And then with Nick Bride, Dale Clarion, they did our comprehensive plan. They will do our historic preservation plan as well. That was signed. There was initial talk of having Liz come here, Liz Fields, I believe it's Liz Fields, to come here and speak and kind of tell you their process, what they would like to do, and receive input from you. She was unfortunately not able to make it today, but she will be scheduled for next month if we have quorum. Or if not, then we can call it like a training session or an executive session and have a meeting there. And then if you guys would like, we can call the Ask the Historical Society to come either to that meeting, or I can see if she can come to a separate meeting that we can have with them. I think it would be ideal to bring them into the fold. So just looking for thoughts and opinions on that or questions.
I don't have any objection to them showing up.
No.
We appreciate the input.
Yeah. If you guys have any questions for her, you can always email me immediately. I mean, between now and then, and I guess just come with questions or thoughts, concerns that you guys will have, or if there's anything that you might want, think that you might want to have added to the historic preservation plan. She's very open to input, so.
So 125 South Main transferred in April of this year.
Yep.
For 115.8 to somebody in Westchester?
I believe so, but they said that the person has abandoned the structure and we're gonna have to board it up soon.
Hmm.
Board up the bottom floor.
It's in a hot area for homeless, so I mean when they see it's empty, regardless of who has it.
Right.
Somebody paid $115,000 6 months ago. And then abandoned it.
Yeah,
that makes sense.
No, is that,
so
it's thinking the same thing.
It's a good
something I've learned, being in this role, is nothing makes sense.
Mm.
when people own a property, I mean, we have a lot of abandoned homes that are gorgeous, whether they're in the historic district or
mm-hmm.
not, and it's a little mind-boggling.
Okay. So Levi resigned?
He said he was going to send me a formal response, but he did send me confirmation in email. I spoke to the clerk of council. She said that is enough to confirm his resignation. And I've sent kind of like the requirements of what the historic commission should have. That includes
mm-hmm.
an architect or an engineer. I think those are the two descriptors that were missing. Architect, landscape architect, city planner, one slot. An engineer is another slot that we do not have.
Did he have a reason or just?
He moved to Hamilton, so legally he can no longer be on the board.
Okay.
Do we need to make a motion to accept his resignation, or is that council's job?
Council's.
Yeah, along those lines, I think my term is up this year.
I spoke to Amy Spank, and she said she's going to provide me when she comes back on Monday the list of whose terms are ending. Whose term started and kind of.
Yeah, and
we need to, but we need to fix that because we're not properly staggered.
Right.
Right. Yeah, I'm just pretty sure that it's this year, and I'm not going to resubmit. It's been on here forever. And
yeah.
When I hit 75, I'm awful. I'm not even on the historic board now. I dropped out of that.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then the police commission, I'll drop out this year too. That way I can just stay at home when it snows and
uh-huh.
I have these meetings.
On the company website, it says term goes through 2023. Is that January 2023 or is that December 2023?
Mine expires in 2022, so I'm thinking December 31st.
I would think so, but
yeah,
I don't know.
Yeah,
I think that's when it is.
Yeah.
It ends at the end of the year.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's it.
Question for you.
Yes.
You had 2700 Central in here.
I mean, these slides.
And said
it was a brick home.
Was that something coming up with that property?
Nope, that was.
It was a long time ago.
Yeah, that was from, I believe, the August meeting that we had.
Fence or something?
I think it was for a fence.
It's a
yeah.
problem cut and paste.
Nothing is going on with that property. It was just a typo on my behalf.
So. The old Masonic Temple, it's in the historic district, isn't it?
The one that's off of, that's like the triangle parcel that's on Roosevelt and Graham?
No.
The one, the old Masonic.
It is,
right.
It's on the historic.
That's my old house.
Yeah. Typically, they've been good about their art projects coming in and getting approval when they were in the UCC district, back when we did stuff there, and in the historic district. But they seem to be doing an art project on their building now.
Is it the stone on the bottom that they just painted?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I noticed that today. We'll send them a letter.
They
yeah.
come to us for their front door.
Right.
Or lighting that they had outside.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, they know that they're supposed to.
Yeah.
I mean, I can't imagine that we're going to deny it, given all the other art projects that we've approved.
They're the one that sort of sponsored that mural
mm-hmm.
on the side of Cincinnati State Building.
Mm-hmm.
And it, you know, got hit by a car, and there's like three panels missing.
I know where one of them is. It's on the side of our building for some reason.
Is it?
Yes, yeah, solar panels. It lost another one. So it had been three down. I think it's four down now. The problem is that they've got so few students coming up there anymore. I'm not sure to what degree they're prepared to invest more money into the building.
No, that was since they stayed, they should put the money out. It was the Whitmans went, they're the ones that brought the application.
Mm-hmm.
Pushed it.
Yes, but I think that the Cincinnati State, once it was a part of the building, and they were became the owner of it.
All right.
I may be wrong, but that was my, that was a donation to them.
The Cincinnati State building?
Yeah, the
Perry Thatcher
Memorial thing.
So not only has it still not been fixed, but it's lost another panel.
I remember there was some sticking points on that, and it was one of my first historic commission meetings. And the conversation, you three will remember, was it looked like a political sign.
It did.
Like someone was running
blue.
That's something we shouldn't have ever done.
Yeah.
Blue and orange aesthetically did not seem very clean.
I bring that up for James and Sam, because we had
it does look like blue, so I had to say that.
Yeah, and I didn't even think about that, but the discussion, that's what it was.
It had that style of the Obama.
Yeah, like what next? Like someone running for mayor, they can have a mural on the side of the building. And
Perry was dead, so.
Right.
Yeah.
But I think that it was just the, well, if we approve this, then if Sam wants to run for council, then he could just put a mural up on the building across the street, as long as it's a mural.
I'll approve it.
Appreciate that. Done.
As long as it's a mural, then no big deal. But
yeah.
But that's what that was.
See, I guess we.
But I think we unanimously approved it.
Which means it falls under our purview, so have we told them to get it fixed?
We were supposed to. We had addressed it in meetings before, I remember, since it happened. I think at least twice it's come up.
The Perry Thatcher building.
Yeah.
The Perry Thatcher mural on the Cincinnati State building.
When you pull out of here and start heading south, you can't miss it. It's on the side.
Oh, I know exactly which one you're talking
can't
about.
Can't miss it.
I don't remember us talking about it, so it must have been before my time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But
I think it's like
when
you talk to the
home.
Local people and they say, well, it's not in our purview. You have to go to the people downtown, and the people downtown get whatever correspondence is sent to them and set it aside. And
so is it just we need them to fill out a COA application to be approved?
No, they need them to fix it.
We approved it years ago.
Okay.
They didn't approve it in a state of disrepair.
So since then, it's fallen apart.
Okay.
It's sitting there missing panels.
I think it's Corey.
Yeah, so we feel like since we were the ones who approved it, we should be the ones to point out that it's missing panels.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
We are. It's now an element of the building. It's now an element of the historic structure, which is being kept in disrepair, and we are telling them, repair it.
And we've also got two buildings of South Main that are going up for auction.
Peggy's.
Peggy's is one.
Dr. Baker's.
Yeah.
Doctor.
Urologist there.
Makes me nervous.
Which one?
Both of them.
Well, the fact that apparently there is the one for Dr. Baker's office apparently a best offer with no reserve.
Right.
It means God only knows someone's going to come in and pick it up cheap with no earthly idea of how much money they're going to have to maintain it. And, well, they'll drop money on it and then just walk away from it.
Hopefully not.
And that's located between the American Legion that doesn't look like it's historical.
Yeah.
And
the Oaks.
No,
the old Parrot.
It's the old Parrot restaurant.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Restaurant.
Which is abandoned.
Well, technically, the American Legion is a historic building. The problem is that its facade was removed like 80 years ago.
The second floor.
Yeah.
58.
There was a second floor?
Yeah.
We were a Boy Scout.
It was a real nice Victorian
yeah.
house.
Yeah, when Colonel White. Anderson or somebody.
There's
yeah.
pictures on the inside.
Yeah,
yeah.
That's where I was going.
But it's a remnant of a historic structure rather
right.
than a modern structure.
What was it originally called?
I think it was Colonel White.
What is it? What is it now?
It's American Legion Post 218.
Very specific answer.
World Fish Rise, right?
Yeah.
Good fish too.
So think about that. That's what it was.
Whose house was it?
It looks like it was always the Legion. It was built by Captain Robert Wilson, a Civil War.
Wilson.
Yeah.
Captain Wilson.
And basically, that's what's left of it now.
Yeah, the office.
Yeah.
You go through the front door, and the officers in that hallway and everything there. That's the part of the original house.
Yeah.
So it's still there. The basement part of it's still original.
Additionally, we have we've had a new hire in code enforcement. We've had one code enforcement officer specialist, I don't know the correct term, go from helping us in the office back into the field.
Mm-hmm.
So for a long, and then we've had the one who, I believe she broke her knee, tore her knee up, she came back. So our code enforcement is back up to, I believe, 4, maybe now 5. We were running on 1 for several months. So
we can talk.
It just started this week. So maybe not, but
no, I meant we could tell that we've been running on 1.
Oh yes, we've been running on one employee for a very, very long time.
So we can refer what to code enforcement.
So anytime
we see someone that
well,
has their yard, it's not cut, not keeping it up to date.
So
in the historic area.
Yeah. If it's
okay.
Building related, such as that, like paint chipping, if it's like tall grass, trash in the yard, etc. You can always file that online through a citizen serve, or you can call Cindy, or you can message me and I can forward that on. Additionally, whenever you've emailed me about properties, which I believe the only one has is Jeremy. you email me about properties, I send that to code enforcement, I have them go out, they go through that process, and then generally I have them come speak to me the week before, or like the week of this meeting, to give me an update, so I can give you an update.
But in theory, if we believe that the structure is basically in danger, right, then we have some heavier armaments that we can request that they pull out to try to save it. But we need to be aware that it's in danger. So we either need to be identifying the buildings ourselves or having them brought to our attention by code enforcement.
Any updates on the U.S. Hotel?
I have emailed the owner, Tyler with Malian Partners LLC, no response. I've informed him of the pathway of reapplying through a hardship back to the Historic Commission, and then if you know the whole entire pathway back gets denied, I believe it goes to Planning Commission, and then to the courts after that, the small claims court, or not small claims, it's
Common
Police Court would be following that. So I've explained all that to him. I've sent him his outcome letter. I've yet to hear anything back. He has 90 days from the time of the last meeting. I think we're getting pretty close. Yeah.
But honestly, given the state that building is in, we probably need to be escalating the code enforcement on it. Basically saying, getting a building inspector outside there saying that these are the things that are endangering this building, repair them or we're going to take action.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. That looks great on paper. We actually have some garages on South Main.
It's like a mother-in-law suite to me.
Yeah.
If you want a project,
that might not be good.
Peggy's house has a garage just like that, a 4-car garage.
Ideally, the city would actually do the repairs, put a lien on the property, and if the person didn't satisfy it, seize it. I mean, I don't think that the city has the budgets.
Yeah. That's
right. You want
the as far as I understand,
no,
the structural integrity of the U.S. Hotel.
Yeah.
I got a house.
The only thing that's holding up the building that's beside it. And our roof is leaking.
massive
fire damage, and if that goes down, then it could be very detrimental to that block. So I will ask code enforcement to please escalate activity on the U.S. Hotel building, and we'll go from there. You guys have any other interested properties that you would like me to ask code enforcement to go check out please email me, let me know.
Okay.
And that kind of covers it all for me for new and old built business.
So if you can just ask the Arts Central Foundation to submit a certificate of appropriateness, I mean, I don't think that there's probably going to be any issue with it, but I...
What is it?
They're basically, well, they got the a new art presentation thing in their window, but they're
painting
they painted
the
all the stone
solid.
Gray, and now they're painting
hands
individual
on.
Stones in different colors. So they're basically doing a mural-like project on their own building as they've done on other buildings through the city.
I see painting stone is probably not too different than painting brick, right? Which we have a problem with.
Yeah. But we've approved all their murals up to this point in when they were.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Anything else? Motion to adjourn? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
The issue that I had with that one is that it was basically appeared to be temporary. Basically a sign that they're calling a mural just so that they could.
Well, one mural we approved is at Portfolio. Portfolio?
Porticopia?
Yeah, Porticopia.
We did not approve that.
We
rejected it.
They did it anyway. Yeah, it's dead now.
Yeah. Right. Well, that's what we